thank you very much for coming. I will try and stick to some sort of organized format of talk, which I'm not always great at. So I'll start today by starting with today. So today, we had an interesting spectacle occurring, and I'll probably at the end of the talk come back to today. But just for a moment, I want to think about the inauguration that happened down in DC, and I want to think about how it's presented, how it's consumed, who the people were, who the players are, how they've set themselves up, you know, to face reality, how that reality is then interpreted. Okay, so Donald Trump is being talked about as the first, you know, entertainment president, the first reality star president. And to a large degree, that's accurate, but it's not entirely accurate. American politics has been had a lot of rhetoric in it ever since Andrew Jackson made little flyers of himself sitting on his porch, putting his feet up on Cracker Barrels. And in the 1950s, Ely Kazan made a great film with Andy Griffith called Face in the Crowd. Anyone? Yeah. Absolutely. Did they? Okay. Ah, well, amen for that. So again, entertainment now both providing us with models and anti-models. So we'll get into that a little bit. So, but again, today I just want to think about who this guy is and where most people know him from. Not being a big reality TV watcher, although lots of other TV watcher I am, I was surprised to find out that The Apprentice had been on for 10 years. And that's a long fucking time. It's three times as long as the original Star Trek series, plus a year. So it gives you a sense of how much it may be ingrained into people. And in fact, today, when we were watching on Channel 7 interviews of people at the inauguration, one guy actually said that the inspiration for him voting for Trump was watching him on The Apprentice. And so when we talk about entertainment and we think about entertainment, we have to understand that it's a lot more than just watching the Andy Griffith Show or watching Friends or watching, you know, whatever, Big Bang, whatever your favorite little show is. It's actually a thing that's creating reality around us at all times. And so let me go back in history a little bit and think about, what is the entertainment industrial complex? Because it sounds a little odd. Everybody's familiar with the one that Eisenhower talked about, right? The one that Eisenhower talked about in 1960 when he was leaving office was the combination of military contractors, military advisors, and people inside the government who would form a consensus of opinion about a particular thing and then go a certain way with it. And what he was warning about was this particular connection of people who were sometimes in official capacity and sometimes in private capacity, working in concert for ends that may not, in fact, be best for the country as a whole. Right? And that military-industrial complex has exploded in the latter half of the 20th century in the United States. There's a great documentary by Eugene Jarecki called Why We Fight, if you haven't seen that one. And the essential answer to the question is why we fight is because we create weapons. We make weapons, and weapons make money in our country. Right? And this is now an issue globally because, you know, the United States wages global warfare with drones because the Americans and the Israelis sell drones. And then we get our politicians to buy them, right? So a lot has to do with the availability and then the use of. So the military-industrial complex is the model I initially thought of when thinking about this topic. But then I realized, historically speaking, there have been lots of industrial complexes. In ancient Egypt, you had the pyramid industrial complex, right? In the Middle Ages, you had the cathedral industrial complex. In ancient China, you had the Taoist emperor industrial complex. And what it really means then is a series of interlocking interests that, in a sense, characterize what is at the center of any given civilization or culture. Right? Culture is the result of how people think about things and then how they act on those beliefs that they have about those things which they think about. How cosmology forms their behavior. And for human beings, for essentially as long as we've been alive, for 185,000 years of hunter-gatherer and 15,000 some odd years of agrarian and 200 some odd years of industrial and 50 years of mass, maybe mass media, and 20 years of IT society, we always have things we tell ourselves. We have stories that oftentimes become more real than reality itself. When I teach ancient Greece, I teach the politics and history part of a core set of courses, and the other side of the thing is the humanities part. So when I'm teaching the Republic, when I'm teaching Marcus Aurelius, they're reading the Iliad or the Odyssey or Gilgamesh or something. And so there's this interplay in my program and in my classes between how people think about things, i.e. philosophy and politics, and then the other half, what stories they tell themselves. And in the ancient Greeks particularly, this is immensely important because the stories of the Iliad and the idea of what it was to be heroic and erete and hubris, whatever, were really real for the Romans and the Greeks. It became the model. Achilles was the model for what an ancient Greek is supposed to be. When Nietzsche writes Genealogy of Morals, it's shorthand for him to use Achilles to mean what it is to be Greek. And what it was to be Greek was to kill real good, to kill lots of people real good, because in the story, this is what gets valued. And Achilles is the hero because he does those things that the Greeks like so well. And one of the things that's needed in a Greek city-state, when you've got lots of little city-states spread out throughout the Aegean, competing for limited amounts of arable land, is being able to protect yourselves, right? And the Spartans take this to a bizarre dystopic level where every man and women, to a large degree as well, are essentially part of the military. Men starting at the age of 12, and when they're 60, they get to go back home from the barracks. That type of society is predicated on a belief of what it is to be a person in a given society. And for the Greeks, it was to be a good soldier. It was to be a winner. Right? There's no second place in ancient Greece. This is not, you know, we now have silver medals and bronze medals. The Greeks, it's like, it is like that, here we go, right? Here's how we reference reality. It's like that moment in the Ricky Bobby movie when he has misconstrued, when Will Ferrell has misconstrued what his father said is, you're either first or you're last. Well, actually, for the ancient Greeks, that's right. You were either first or you were last. And that being first, you win an Olympic event, you may never have to buy food again in your life in ancient Greece because you're the guy who won that event. And where do they get these ideas about what it is? Well, they get those ideas from the stories they tell themselves about the universe they live in. Those stories create both meaning and causality as well as morality. And so again, when Nietzsche talks in his Genealogy of Morals about what was to be good in the ancient Greek world as opposed to what is to be good in the Christian world as opposed to what is to be good in the modern world, the 19th century, we use the same terminology, but at each time, the explication of what is to be good is told through metaphoric stories. In the ancient Greek world, it's the Iliad and the Odyssey. In the world that he's talking about in the post-Roman world, in the Christian world, it's the stories in the Bible. For us today in the United States, 50%+ of Americans believe that the world is 6,000 years old. It was Mike Pence, for God's sake, right? The new vice president, and 50% of conservative Republican congressmen. Where do they get that from? They get it from a story. And that story itself is a combination of many other traditions, bringing together parts of the Middle East, parts of the Levant, parts of the Fertile Crescent, the Babylonian Empire, the Mesopotamians, the Egyptians. It's very likely that the early god for the Canaanites who became the Jews was the god of wisdom, El, plus the Canaanite water deity, Ah. And this is how you get maybe who is Yahweh, and then later God the Father, and then later Allah. But again, in each of these situations, it's the stories people tell themselves about the world they live in that creates the reality they inhabit. And so when we talk about the entertainment industrial complex, what we're really talking about is a particular type of culture. Because that's what, again, that's what culture is. The stories you tell yourself to give meaning to your life and to order the universe. And oftentimes, reality is less important than the story. Think back to 9/11. And those of you who are in the city, and those of us who were unfortunate enough to see the events unfold, to see the buildings collapse, virtually every person I spoke to said something on the scale or on the page of, it was like the movie Independence Day. And everything, then, we have to think about how much of everything gets mediated, how much of reality, what we're actually living through, gets mediated through some fictionalized version of what reality is. Fiction sometimes really bugs the shit out of me, because you can make anything happen. And the good guys win, and the bad guys lose, and the guy and the gal, the guy and the guy, and the girl and the girl, the dog and the guy, and whoever, whatever you want to get together, gets together. And that's how you have a happy ending. Remember in the 19th century what the English did to Shakespeare. Romeo and Juliet didn't really drink poison, it was just a sleeping drought. And then they all wake up and everybody's like, Bowdrize, right? You rewrite the stories to give them happy endings, because tragedy sucks. Tragedy sucks because it's a sad ending. Now, interestingly enough, the Greeks loved tragedy. The Greeks lived in a world in which they thought the gods could fuck you at any moment. That, I mean, I kind of agree with that world a little bit more than I do with lots of other cosmologies, but it can feel like that sometimes. I mean, remember, what's the Greek version of your life? It's the fates sitting there watching your life with a little pair of scissors, and just at some moment when they fucking feel like it, bam. 12 years ago, there was a rainstorm in Queens with very heavy winds, and it knocked over a huge tree that fell on a school bus that killed 3 little girls. What kind of fucking god would do that? Well, there were lots of answers. Well, a god who knows what you don't know, a god that was saving them from something. All of these stories were mediated through the Bible or other religious texts. The book of Job was mentioned quite often in some of the articles I read, which is, boy, getting the Job in anything modern, that's impressive. And even the book of Job, too. Remember, what was that about for the people who are reading it? Why does it seem sometimes that good things happen to bad people? Oh, yes, the election. Then bad things happen to good people. Well, you never know. It's God playing dice with Satan. And that's why things sometimes suck, and you don't know why they suck, because who are you to encompass what God says? So again, our reality of experiencing life is being mediated through an idea of what supernaturality is. And that idea of supernaturality still, without question, in my mind, holds sway in the world today, period, full stop. We have a world with 7.5 billion people. I believe that's the correct number. Is that right? Not an ascension? Or okay. Or do the Indian thing, and then I won't know what it is. Point what? Oh, Jeb Bush. Okay, yeah. So 7.5 billion people. Now, this is something I go through in my class quite often. We talk about, what do people know about what? Now, the demographic at NYU is relatively consistent. Whether they're a kid from Long Island, a kid from the OC in California, or a kid from Shanghai, the main thing that they demographically share in common is $72,000 a year somehow to pay for school. Okay. Now, that specific data point creates a demographic that is actually reasonably narrow in its field of experience and expectations. In other words, most of them are there because somebody expected them to go to college. And when we have the conversations about, well, did anyone talk about maybe taking a year off? My favorite story is the kid who was talking to this about his mom on the way to the airport who pulled over and threatened to hit him if he one more mentioned not going to college, because that wasn't what was expected of them in their sooner. So the demographic of people I teach are relatively narrow in their experience and their horizons. We all tend to think of the world as relatively similar, and people often think that the world thinks like them, particularly when you don't move outside your demographic. So we're sitting in a classroom imagining people have some sort of shared idea about how reality works, and then, of course, it's important to remember and to remind them that the kids who came from India need to recheck the India Times, because remember, they just burned a witch. And they're eating and killing and then eating albinos in parts of Africa. And in places in America, the school board, with the encouragement of Betsy Davros, I want to say Davros because that's the guy who created the Daleks, but it's not Davros, it's DeVos. She's getting creation textbooks into science classes in schools around the country, because for creationists, the idea that God wasn't in charge is a universe that they can't handle. It's too scary. Conspiracy theorists, too, by the way, back to 9/11. One of the interesting things that conspiracy theory does is it gives you a narrative to hold on to. The world is not subject to the whims of 19 guys with box cutters. That's scary. It's actually Bush, the International Monetary Fund, led by Peter Graves, the cabal of the Enlightenment, and some Jews in Zurich. See, those guys, and that's a big one, like the Protocols of the Elders of Zion are one of my favorite bizarre moments in like storytelling, paranoia, and politics. But we'll come back to that today, because again, there was a term that our new president used that for me as an American historian almost made my head pop off. America first. This was a fascist you know, anti-Semitic, anti-foreign, America first, pro-America statement that comes out of 1930s American populism slash fascism, the Huey Long type nonsense, right? And when he said that, now I don't know what Donald Trump knows. I really don't know what Donald Trump knows. I can't even begin to imagine sometimes what I think he should know and maybe what he doesn't actually know. I have to imagine there's somebody somewhere in the Trump universe who realized that the phrase America first was somehow connected to fascism, and they didn't mind because they're telegraphing perhaps that meaning to those group of followers, wink, wink, nod, nod, we're right with you. But it's important for us to remember that words are actually important. So this entertainment industrial complex that we're dealing with now is an interlocking network of, say, let's say, the people who produce content. There are currently something like 425 separate new TV shows on at the current moment. That includes traditional television, cable television, and things like Netflix shows. It's the largest number ever, according to Nielsen. So we have 425 different creations of recreations, positings of what reality is that people can get lost in. And so this interlocking thing involves the people who produce them, the people who pay for them, the people who act in them, and the governments that sanction them. And let's be really clear about something in the United States. Every time you have a film in which you see an actual battleship being used, or real locations that are government property, FBI offices, or say Quantico, or the CIA buildings. Understand that, or movies like American Sniper, or Zero Dark 30. Those movies are made in conjunction with the US Department of Defense through their Public Affairs Office, which means that the message has been approved by the US government. Which then means we're now dealing with Chomsky's issue about manufacturing consent or the good old-fashioned word propaganda. But what we again need to, I think, differentiate the contemporary industrial entertainment industrial complex and from previous forms of storytelling is the magnitude and the breadth of which stories are now told. The only possible similar historical connection to today's mass entertainment, mass communication, mass production is maybe, and it's a very strong underlined, bold, italic, quotation marks, asterisk, maybe, the common stories told within a given religious tradition. So if everyone's telling the story about Jesus dying and being born again, that's kind of like mass communication, even though, yeah, there's a tremendous variance in how each person still interprets and tells that story. Right? There were lots of Christians in 1000 AD in Western Europe and parts of the Near and Middle East, but most of the ones in Europe were actually Arian Christians. Those of you who don't know what Arian Christianity is a heretical form of Christianity which says that Christ is not equal to God. That's where you get the Nicene Creed from, that Jesus is begotten, not made, being of one substance by the Father, of whom all things are made. Right? And the idea that Christians are Christians is actually not that accurate because the story they tell themselves about who Jesus is are important enough for them to kill each other over. And so now when we start talking about political wars or religious wars or race wars or ethnic conflict, what we're now talking about is conflicts possibly brought on simply because of the different stories people are telling each other about reality. I mean, I hope it never comes to Star Trek fans duking it out seriously with Star Wars fans, but I do remember a couple years ago there was a Comic-Con in England where they mixed it up a little bit. Now, I'm not sure if it's a hate crime to say, you stupid fucking Trekkie, you know. I don't know, but we are certainly seeing in our culture a certain amount of tribalism, right, around our TV watching, our entertainment consumption. So let's talk about mass media then for a second. When does the era of mass media start? I think the easy first answer is to look at the era of print and the beginning of the era of print in the West. Now, it is absolutely positively true that Chinese culture, Chinese civilization had printing presses well before the West did. Chinese culture also had gunpowder and compasses, and they didn't tend to go around the rest of the world blowing up people and then saying, oh my, your land, not yours, now mine, right? They didn't colonize, didn't do a lot of things differently. So why Chinese culture didn't develop the same sort of mass culture with printing presses, why they didn't develop industrialization the same way that the West is, I will leave that for the Asian scholars. I'm going to talk about the West and its reality after the printing press, which is all of a sudden I can print something up and I don't have to wait for a bunch of monks to copy it and get, oh, I got a copy. That only took 3 weeks. Let me start again, okay? Understand that, like, manuscripts were rare at rare book room, appropriate moment for this, right? These were rare and important because they were rare and important. The thing was the thing itself. Now, when you start printing them up, fuck, man. It's less than 70 years later that you get the Reformation in Europe. And it hasn't been like there weren't Christians for 1,200 years questioning the Catholic Church. It was just really that all of a sudden, once you put the 95 Theses on the cathedral at Wittenberg, you could then take it and copy it and send it around. Now, interesting alternate history. If they had had fax machines and airplanes, no Reformation. Hey, look what this guy just put on the wall. Send it down to the Pope. Oh my God, send someone, oh my. It's like instead of the 3 months, hey, someone up in, you know, man, Germany is writing stuff. Well, go find out what they're writing. Okay, okay. 6 weeks later. So what are these people saying? Oh, I've got a copy of it. Okay, well, I'll take it down to the Pope. Here's what they're saying. Oh, God, this is what they're saying. Well, we better write something. Okay. Then we better get it up to Germany. Okay. And then, you know, like 8 years later, there's a response. Great example of this, and one often used by historians on television to say that George III of England is stupid. And it's asinine because they're stupid. No, you're stupid. No, you're stupid for doing this. Apparently, George III, on July 4th, 1776, wrote in his diary, "Nothing much happened today." But are you kidding? The American Declaration of Independence was published. The states are in rebellion. It's freedom. God damn it, man. Of course the fucking king didn't know what happened. It took you 6 weeks to find out what happened because it was that far away. Even the first telegraph message that is sent transatlantic in like 1842 took 17 minutes. That's how long it took, right? And so one of the things we need to think about the modern entertainment industrial complex is the speed at which things can be reproduced and disseminated and how widely disseminated they are. Because even in the world of printing, there is what you might call the pre-industrial world of printing that lasts through the 15th, 16th, 17th, 18th, and early part of the 19th century. And that's the kind of printing that you can see sort of on display back there with this little teeny press they've got, in which someone is sliding a thing with letters, typeface and letters, and wet ink into a space on a printer. They put the paper on it, you take the thing, you hang it on down, and you turn it around, and it presses it, and then you take the paper, and you walk over here, and then you hang it up on here. And then you go do your other one. Now, if you wanted to go quick, you would be sloppy with the amount of ink you put out, because that would go you a little faster. Now, there's a historian named Robert Darton, D-A-R-N-T-O-N, who writes a lot about this. His real big book is called The Business of the Enlightenment. And he goes into excruciating detail, not only about the technology of printing, but what the reality of printing did. Because, you know, once you had books that could be printed in the dozens, or the hundreds, or the thousands. Now, let me tell you, a best-selling book in the 18th century was like 5,000 copies. So when you want to talk about creating public debate, let's go to the first arguably big, other than God and Jesus and, you know, killing people and shit for God, which was a very big argument in the early, you know, years of printing, arguably the first, like, real big public sphere controversy is the French Revolution. And there's this thing in England called the French Revolution debate that starts in 1789 when Joseph Priestley gives a talk at his church in London about nationalism and patriotism and the natural rights and so on. And in response to that, Edmund Burke writes Reflections on the French Revolution, which sells 30,000 copies. This is huge. And that is an extraordinary number of books. And that's a pretty big record until Tom Paine. Thomas Paine answers with books Rights of Man, Part 1 and 2, that sell between 5 and 600,000 copies. Thomas Paine probably sold more books than anybody else in the 18th and 19th century, maybe with the exception of someone like Dickens. Okay. But this is a whole other scale. Now, this is still with this little, the rotary press, ka-chunk, 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 comes in, and all of a sudden, the face, no pun intended, of printing changes. And the way in which printing pays for itself changes too. So, hold on. In the 16th, 17th, 18th, and early 19th century, your newspaper, your magazine, your atlas, your journal, your folio, your oleo of some kind, was generally paid for actually by subscription. This is why when you do your research and you go and you're a diligent grad student like I was back in the pre-computer days and you get your 18th century newspapers and I'm looking for advertising from carriage makers or saddle makers or anyone who does equipage because I wrote about that really broad subject of interest that everybody's dying to learn about, which is the American carriage industry and how it transformed from a craft to an industry, right? Are you with me? There were no ads. What it basically was this little page of squares that says, I sell horseshoes. I'm available to make shoes. I'm a male, but and there is no such thing as advertising in the sense that we think of it, because newspapers and magazines and even books are paid for by subscription. So when you wander through this rare book room and you pick up anything prior to 1800, it will often say by subscription on the first title page, and it will then let you know oftentimes how many were printed. But when the rotary press comes in, and the ability to print things on a scale not just arithmetically larger, but like exponentially larger, then changes the economics of printing, of journalism, of writing. Now, this shared experience of having a newspaper, this guy Jürgen Habermas says, creates a public sphere where for the first time politics isn't just happening in the king's court. Because until then, and this is a, you know, this is a great way in which the ancient Chinese and the ancient Greeks are really different. The ancient Chinese, there was no question of who was to be in charge. It's the emperor. The only question was how much is the emperor in line with Tao? Is he Ren? Is he got the Wei Wu going, right? Is he able to do without doing? Can he lead without lead? I love this Taoist stuff. You don't got to do a thing, really. So there was no argument. And this is why when Confucius writes about politics, it's really all about how are you in line or not with the Wei. The Greeks, wholly different scenario. Coming, and I believe, you know, most people tend to make the argument that this is a geographic thing. I don't want to go all Jared Diamond, but when you look at ancient Greece, the reality is, as I said earlier, lots of little small city-states. Lots of little small city-states who all rule themselves slightly differently. So one of the things the Greeks can see that the Chinese may not is that there are actually different ways of ruling yourselves. The fucking Egyptians didn't have any arguments about who was going to be in charge. It was going to be the pharaoh, because the pharaoh has to die, cross the river, get into the afterlife, then come and make the sun come up the next day. And if he doesn't get there, holy shit, that's why we need to build this pyramid. And everybody did it. Now look, the first thing we need to make sure we get rid of is the idea that the pyramids were made by slaves in general. Now, of course, there were some slaves, but in the main, it was a lot like feudalism. Your responsibility as a good Egyptian, because of the stories you heard and the shit that they carved on the wall. I mean, talk about permanent advertising. I mean, you've still got people who are tourists in ancient Egypt looking at 4,000-year-old propaganda about how the emperor killed all the, they killed the Ammonites or the Hittites or the Abnites or the Jezebites or all lots of ites being killed, right? And that's its own little form of propaganda, but it's really only effective to the people who can get to it. But it's the same idea that I create the reality of who the emperor is. And these people in ancient Egypt, it was important. There's a city called Dar al-Madinah that was discovered outside of Cairo, which was a worker city. And what we discovered is that essentially, again, there's a pyramid industrial complex, and where there's a whole professional class of people and government line expenditures for building temples and pyramids. And on their off hours, those workers are building their own little temples, or their own little tombs themselves, the same way that, you know, the guy who may work at McDonnell Douglas goes home and works on a 65 Chevy. And we know this because they left records of what they did with their time in their lives and why they did it. And so in the up until about 1820, this idea from, say, again, 1458, I think, is when when What's-His-Face publishes Gutenberg, his first book. You've got this small circle, but it's bigger than it used to be, because now we can read a newspaper and hear about the news from London or hear about the news from Paris, hear about how they're doing things, and now we can have a discussion that's how are people doing things and what do I think about how people are doing things, and me expressing what I think about how people are doing things is public opinion. There is no public opinion until the early modern period because there's no way to create public opinion. That doesn't mean there aren't shared ideas, myths, stories, whatever, but that's different from public opinion. So from the beginning of the from the end of the early modern age, when presses start to become mass production, like you have in factories for consumer goods, remember, mass production requires mass consumption. And any good Marxist will tell you, when your consumption isn't maxing your production, you're going to have serious problems. Okay. So similar thing happens in printing. And instead of being able to just to make my money by selling the newspapers, because now I'm printing hundreds of them, I got to find another way to get revenue. And all of a sudden, advertising. Kaboing. Advertising is a way to make lots of money, not by the content per se of your newspaper, not by the sale of the newspaper, i.e. how much money you get for the newspaper. Rather, you get paid, as everyone knows, for the circulation, the number of eyeballs. Actually, we've had an interesting lesson in this in the last election, right, with the fake news sites that apparently, and this was, you know, I'm relatively oblivious sometimes to the present moment. But, you know, this fake news thing, if you don't understand how it works, it's real simple. It's clicks. So someone writes the story that Hillary Clinton is running a child sex ring, and it spreads like wildfire because a percentage of the population wants to believe that about her. And so that story, and again, the idea of it being viral is a really good metaphor or analogy, right? It spreads through contact. And in the social media universe, which is a whole other bunch of words we'll have to deal with at the very end, social media itself is almost contradictory, but these things spread. They fit in the worldview that people already want, and it activates a guy from, I think, North Carolina to get in his truck with his machine gun and go up to the pizza store and stop this criminal activity from happening. But why do those stories get written? They get written because when they get reposted and people read them, you get paid for the advertising time that is generated by people sharing and clicking on them. It is the height of capitalist information spreading. It doesn't matter what the information necessarily is, and it certainly doesn't matter if it's true. What matters is that people consume it in some fashion. Its consumption generates revenue. So if you've ever wondered why in that bleary-eyed morning after God knows what, when you come home at 3:30 in the morning and you're saying, why the fuck is there an half an hour long commercial for an automatic bread baker slash hair toupee maker? The answer is because somebody's making money somehow, either selling the bread maker toupee maker or the advertising time itself. And in fact, probably two things are happening. The bread maker toupee maker is actually probably selling, much to your and my bleary-eyed surprise. And it's worth it for the TV station. In other words, I'm only going to be 50, and I'm already getting waxing romantic, right, about my good old days of the 70s, when there was a movie on Channel 5 at 2 o'clock in the morning that was called Hollywood's Greatest. It usually wasn't, but it was better than 4 infomercials in a row. And so someone at this TV station is making a numbers judgment. What's better for us to run? Original programming? Absolutely not. Very, very, very expensive. Repeat programming? Well, maybe. It depends on how much we get. Or someone who's dying to get a half an hour telling us about their bread toupee maker. And so again, it becomes an economic decision. So newspapers and mass production are partially a sociological event in terms of people's desire for information, but they're also an economic event because it's a revenue generator. And television and the internet and these things don't exist at this point to share data sets. It's not ARPANET anymore. TV does not exist in the United States anyway to serve a public function. And after Donald Trump gets through with this week, there may not be any PBS left. There may not be any National Endowment for the Humanities left. There may not be any National Endowment, what is it for the arts? What's the one for the arts? National Endowment for the Arts, right? And what's interesting about this is I think we've got to give conservatives a little credit here. They understand that cultural production may have some more impact than simply diversion, which is why they're always so interested in quashing artistic expression that, in whatever reason, they find objectionable. It's usually something that simply expresses a different worldview, and oftentimes the threat here is to their worldview created by their set of acceptable stories, and this other narrative, yeah, I use the word narrative, this other narrative now challenges their global world cosmological narrative. And that's just too much for them to handle, so what do? You stop the narrative. The Catholic Church had a thing called the Index. It lasted up until the mid-20th century. Does anyone know what the Index was? Their list of banned books, which Swiss publishers used as their list of available books. Because if the church is banning it, somebody wants to buy it. Now, that list had things like The Social Contract and Newton, and it also had pornography like What the Butler Saw. Okay? And so for the French government, say in the 18th century, prior to the revolution, censoring pornography about the king was just as important as censoring ideas about politics, because both were dangerous to the harmony of the body politic. And so the conservatives here actually are pretty fucking insightful in their desire to kill the arts and possibly replace it with what's left, commercial arts or commercial cultural production. And here's what gets really weird and interesting. Is entertainment culture culture? Culture, prior to the modern communication era, was either high culture or low culture. Low culture was sometimes called folk culture. And throughout the 19th century, as industrialization provided more and more goods lower and lower down the economic scale, the question began to arise, does low culture mimic high culture, or does low culture have its own sort of set of values and norms and things that it posits about reality? It's an active debate. In Germany and in America, labor historians and culture historians posited that, in fact, working class or working men and lower economic demographic culture was not simply a mimicked expression, albeit cheaper, than high culture. Right? That's Veblen's argument in Theory of the Leisure Class, that modern consumption is driven by people lower down the socioeconomic scale who, through the process of mass production and consumption, can now buy not a tortoiseshell thing, but a plastic thing that looks just like tortoiseshell. You can't buy an original suit, but you can buy an off-the-rack suit, which is why in 19th century America, it was so important to really know the person you were looking at. Because now that I can buy a fancy set of clothes for $5 at Sears and Roebuck and get it delivered to me, I can look like a gentleman, but perhaps not be one. This is why when you read Huckleberry Finn, the character of the Duke is so central to American society and culture in the 19th century. There's a great book by a historian named Karen Haltunen called Confidence Men and Painted Women. And it's all about the crisis created in American and English society when social norms, social standards could always be observed by what the person looked like and what the clothes they wore. Remember, books and people really did look like their covers. If you were a shoemaker or an artisan or a bricklayer or a farmer, that's how you looked pretty much all the time. Remember Monty Python's Holy Grail? How do you know that's not the king? Oh, he's not covered in shit. Yeah, that's about right. Now we can all bathe too, which is a great thing, because people stink in general. And we've got accustomed to a whole new set of values, which are created again around this entertainment advertising culture that says smelling is bad, use ivory soap. And now your personhood gets wrapped up in the consumption you take part in through the memes and the norms that are told to you through the advertising content that supports the narrative or dramatic content which you are consuming. And so now, actually, we've got two things going on. You've got one form of narration of norming going on through the actual narrative show itself, or the documentary, or the news program. And coupled with that, you've got a whole nother stream of identities norming going on through advertising. And here's the interesting and bizarre part. The advertising culture that you and I are so familiar with grew up in the world at the same time as consumer culture and at the same time as democratic culture. And the weird thing is those two things are not compatible. As I said in a talk recently, consumer culture requires you be stupid, uninformed, and gullible. Because you think this soap will make you get back to the heartland of Ireland and have women killing to get you, and that beer really makes you a man, right? I mean, all that stuff is like very important not to know the truth. Because if you know the truth about Coke and Pepsi, it won't matter which one you drink. Your whole identity won't be wrapped up in the Coke wars that were fought, right, in the late 90s. Coke and Pepsi, Coke. And like these people, now think about it. These brands create, again, like I said earlier, forms of tribalism. This identity that we have is then transmitted through these different outlets, the television, the movies, the radio. In fact, it's interesting, and I was surprised when I read this, radio still has the largest audience number in gross figures in the United States. Still more than movies, still more than TV is radio. I know it seems all quaint in mid-20th century. But all of these different outlets, they look different, they seem different, but the reality is in the United States, they're all still giving off that same message of consumption and identity and consumption and identity. So now, our entertainment industrial complex, which remember is this interlocking network of different groups, factions, corporations, and purveyors of product, they are very interested in how their product is presented in any given show or movie, right? We all know what product placement is. Product placement is an amazing, in a sense, an amazing invention. Because, and it's going to be taken to the next step with all your smart TVs, right? You know what's coming is that you will be able to, with your wireless mouse, or maybe you have little laser pointers, you will be able to purchase what you see the people on television wearing. Because we're getting to a point where technology allows that bizarre level of interactivity. Where I can, you know, Ivana Trump, we'll be walking down the thing, and a little thing will pop up and says, buy her bracelet. And so now, what is reality? Wow, I mean, reality is that every moment is an act of possible consumerism, backed by whatever narrative it is that tells you you should be buying this thing. Now, let me just switch gears for a second so we can get towards the roundup here. Because what I'm really concerned about, or what I'm really interested in thinking about, is the politics and the social aspect of our entertainment industrial complex. Where has it brought us? What ideas does it value? What does it do to ideas in terms of diversity? One of the first things mass culture does is it tends to squish the range of possibilities. Right? Even though now we're living in a world of narrowcasting, which you can watch the all fishing channel, or actually the all bass fishing channel, actually, no, the all bass fly fishing channel 24 hours a day because you can't get enough fly fly fishing. There's mud bog drag racing channels. Do you even know what mud bog drag racing is? It's this race where they have cars that are like boats that drive through mud. And guess what they sell on the mud bog drag racing channel? Soap. Yeah, that, we would like to think soap, but no. They sell car products. They sell, you know, like carburetors and air filters and tires and all the thing for the man or woman who needs to get their mud bog drag racer in tip-top shape. Now that sounds all weird and niche-y, but how different is that from the beer ads, the food ad, the car ads, the airplane ads? I mean, airplanes are fucking airplanes. As long as it's not pulling like an Aeroflot dive, we kind of shouldn't care that much. But no, the branding now that comes with like Qatar Air, or what's the Mid-Eastern country? Emirates. I don't know, man. It's just, there's something about Emirates Air that just freaks me out a little bit. And I still know it's just an airline. But think about what's happening. The way you get somewhere via airline, via your car, via whatever, is now an expression of who you are as a person. Because one of the things the entertainment industrial complex does, along with the act of a consumer society, is it's really interested in fitting people into some sort of demographic so we know what narrative to push them to get the product they're looking to buy. And like I said, when we get to that interactive moment where what you're watching, you're literally able to tap on and buy, this is the moment, like Bradbury talks about in Fahrenheit 451, when all four walls of your room are projecting a TV, and you get to answer the line back to the woman in the screen, where that line between what is fantasy and what in reality has completely melted away. It's about 60% gone now. I mean, the selfie thing. I think the selfie thing is like a personal red carpet, right? Because we live in what everybody used to describe as the pre-rich culture, right? Like, it's F. Scott Fitzgerald, who is usually credited with the phrase that all Americans think of themselves as temporarily embarrassed millionaires. It may also be Doctorow, but I think it sounds Fitzgerald-y, so we'll go with that, okay? I think the accurate statement about the majority of Americans' perception about themselves is they're just undiscovered celebrities. Waiting, and I can tell you amongst my students, there is a bizarrely high preponderance of people who want to go into something that is connected in some way with entertainment. Entertainment is the computer programming of the 80s, is the plastic guy of the 60s, is the steam-powered guy of the 1880s. Entertainment is so pervasive in this country that not only does it dominate our consciousness in terms of how we view reality, it is an increasingly huge chunk of our economic pie. Last year, I got my number here, last year, Hollywood films sold over $40 billion worth of product worldwide. Now, that's only the films themselves. That's not associated products, TV rights, da-da-da-da-da. That's a fairly large chunk of money. Watch a film sometime and see how many little villages worth of credits go by before the thing is over. There are hundreds of people now involved in this industry, thousands of people, millions of people. This is why I think of it as an industrial complex, because all of those people are part and parcel of this process of manufacturing a reality for us. And what's possibly most terrifying in 2017, and it really kind of starts earlier on, but what's really terrifying now is, like I said earlier, this dividing line between what is reality and what is fiction. Judith Miller. So, is the New York Times a newspaper, or is the New York Times a daily almanac of foreign short stories? If you're talking about the Judith Miller moment, when you're leading up to the Iraq War, the Bush administration was able to manufacture a narrative, and then, they fucking worked at it. And they borrowed every trick in the book as far back as World War I. When World War I started, printing presses in England and America started making up fake pictures, and you can read about in this fucking Chomsky book, fake pictures of German soldiers bayoneting babies. And there's, oh, God, the Huns are killing babies, and this is disseminated right through this conduit to get out to the press. The Nazis were great with propaganda and movies in the 1930s, absolutely stupendous. I mean, the quality of some of that propaganda product is absolutely staggering. Same should be said for the quality, and I guess we should use it in quotes, of our commercial advertising productions. The production value on any TV commercial is about 10 times that on any average film. If a film cost per minute as much as a TV commercial, your average film would be somewhere in the neighborhood of $500 million. So they spend a tremendous, anybody old enough to remember those Chanel ads with the woman at the pool and the guy diving and he swims through the pool? Anybody with me on this? Am I that fucking out of it? There gotta be people. So that was, do you remember that? Thank you, okay. That commercial was one of the most expensive of its day. It cost $3.5 million for 30 seconds. Wow is right. Now, what that wow should make you think about is how important they think that ad is, that they're willing to spend $3.5 million to sell a perfume that's like $50 a half ounce. Now, again, there's two interesting questions. Is that being done to get everybody to buy it, or just to remind the people who have the $50 an ounce to buy it that they can buy it? It's a very interesting problem, the demographics of advertising. Half or some of it is aspirational and some of it is actual. Remember, the aspirational aspect of American culture is reinforced in every fucking narrative film where you have a rags-to-riches story like Horatio Alger. You know, the really trustworthy and hardworking shoe shine. Yes, sir, Mr. Sir, I'm going to get that shoe. Who gets the help from the friendly old billionaire, you know, but he shows himself trustworthy and works his way up. And yeah, the reality is that the American dream, A, never existed. Never existed. There was not some anomalous social progress in which people worked real fucking hard and they got richer. No, what actually happened in the United States from 1880 to 1980 was every decade, more or less, everybody got about 10% more in their salary. So yes, your grandfather who came over from Indonesia, China, Germany, Italy, I don't know where, the Baltic area, who had nothing in his pocket but an old roll, and now he can send me to America's best college, NYU. Don't you tell me capitalism isn't real. You've got to remind them that that was happening to kind of like everybody's grandfather who came over from the old world with a fucking roll in their pocket. Because there was more stuff happening in America because of this crazy thing called industrialization. I mean, did the Chinese just figure out how to work hard? I mean, that would be the analogous story, because I mean, the past 4,000 years, they weren't doing dick until they got a Foxconn factory to build us iPhones. Now they're diligent workers. Again, what's happening here now is this entertainment industrial complex is actually starting to take over the world. Because remember, this line between reality and fiction, it's not just as obvious as something like Judith Miller, it's also as insidious as someone, like I said, the current president, or even the last president, or even the one before that, or even the one before that. I mean, one of the things that made Bill Clinton so great is that he was so fucking affable. One of the things that made George Bush great is you wanted to have a beer with him. One of the things that made Obama great is, man, the motherfucker could talk. Man, he could communicate. And he could communicate so well that he could make you think that he stands for things that he never said he stood for. And as he wrote in his first book, his greatest political asset is that people project on him the things they want to see him doing. Donald Trump. Donald Trump has managed to create what is perhaps the most successful persona ever. I mean, other than maybe Zeus or Achilles or the Pope, okay? It is the persona, the Pope. I like the Pope. I like this Pope. I mean, there are other popes I have some more problems with, but I mean, in many ways, the Pope is like a reality star. He's drawn from a pretty small group of people. He works through up through the ranks. At the very end, he gets selected, and it's announced with like special smoke. Ooh, right? And just like the Academy Awards, then he comes out and he sees his people and he says, get these Italians off of my lawn. That's what he's really saying when he's doing it, okay? But the Pope is this interesting amalgam of talks to God and celebrity. Right? Celebrity culture also, by the way, is relatively new. Yes, I know we have myths and legends about gods and demigods and saints and stuff. And it is true that those demigods and saints became models of behavior for people all throughout history. I mean, that's one of the ways in which the church controlled people is by giving them models of behavior that was either subservient to the authority of the church, subservient to the representatives of the church, or at least subservient to the power of God as manifest in the church itself. So we have new demigods. And they exist in this realm of manufactured reality where the people, the actors, the Ronald Reagans, the Tom Cruises, the Tom Selleck's, are actually somehow imbued with the qualities of the characters they play. And so this is where you get to the point, like, where is the real Arnold Schwarzenegger? I mean, how many layers of press do we have to get through? How many layers of representation do you have to get to till you get to the actual person, him or herself? In some instances, it's possible that at the core of who that person is a big question mark. Because I would imagine, with possibly after years of creating an image of who you are and multiple levels of presentational models, you may lose yourself. I think Donald Trump has been lost in a role his whole life. It's the role of successful businessman. It's the role of business titan who achieved more than his father. One of his biographers said that the most startling, consistent characteristic about Donald Trump is his insecurity about his accomplishments. So, how do you make up for the insecurity of your actual accomplishments? You take on all the trappings of that success. There seems to be some aesthetic sharing, some aesthetic qualities that are shared both by brutal dictators in the Middle East, mobsters, and Donald Trump. Lots of gilded stuff, like, as someone in an article recently pointed out to me, we have actually elected a guy who lives, who lives in a giant gilded tower and sits on a golden throne. If that is not compensating for, I mean, all sorts of possible things, as the media has liked to talk about, I'm not sure what is. And let me take it one step further. The presentational model that was shown today to the world writ large about what American democracy is itself another narrative being created by and crafted by experts and directors and public relations people so that the image of the United States as a political, socioeconomic entity is consistent. This is why when Donald Trump says things like, I don't know about NATO, I don't know about the one China, I don't know about global warming, the world freaks out because for the last 50 years, America has vacillated between bad managers of the empire, really bad managers of the empire, and competent managers of the empire. But none of the managers of the empire have questioned the empire, because everywhere you look around us, America is presented as the benevolent, the fair, the democratic seeking, the only goes to war when necessary thing. You know, the way that just before the Iraq War in 2003, what was the most present thing for our government to talk about was World War II. Now again, I don't know if it's a coincidence, it's Jesus, or it's fucking the CIA, but one of the most popular movies in the run-up to 9/11 was the movie Pearl Harbor. If you want to create a scenario where people are ready to go for war because they've been snuck up on, Pearl Harbor is the great historical metaphor to use. Of course, that leaves out what the United States was all doing and that we were taking Japanese stuff and it was all about a war for resources and we knew they were coming at some point and then this sneak. George Bush knew they were coming. The August 6th briefing in 2001 said bin Laden determined to attack in the United States. And what spun out from there was an attack and then the creation of a new narrative, the warrior president, right? And the warrior president was discussed in terms that harken back to movies with John Wayne, with his landing on the aircraft carrier wearing a flight suit. And I remember Maureen Dowd writing about how sexy he looked in a flight suit. And there were two things that really freaked me out. A, George Bush being sexy, and B, George Bush in a flight suit being sexy, or maybe three things. Why someone would think a flight suit makes someone more sexy? Except if you have been inculcated with the idea that, oh, like the Greeks, being a warrior, being a good killer, being an adept pilot that strafes over civilians, a la, what's his name, John McCain, then you're going to think it's sexy, because you're going to associate killing good with the positive manly virtues of strength and virility, which you will then associate with the desirability of sexuality and then desirableness. Am I saying that sexuality can actually be created or desire can be created? Fuck yes. Fuck yes. Entertainment culture in connection or in collusion with the advertising world creates your desires, and now it tells you how you've achieved them or not. And it's not the iPhone 6 anymore, now it's the iPhone 7 that's the one you really want, or it's the iPhone 8. And how much do we want it? We want it so much that people, in the same way they did in the Middle Ages or in Tibet, they will make a pilgrimage to the store. They will suffer and brave the elements so they can be the 16th person to get that phone, which if they waited till the next day, there'd be no line, no suffering, no. But I guess it's the suffering that makes the iPhone really worth it. You know, just like Jesus in heaven. And so our entertainment culture now, here's where we end up. You know the kind of values, norms, characters, characterizations that our media pushes on us. I don't know what it bodes for the next 4 years when at the same time Donald Trump is being made president, they are doing a sequel to 24. Do you know how many Americans' whole concept of the war on terror was what was happening with Keith or Sutherland? Probably 90%. Because people don't watch the news, but they watch lots of TV. According to Nielsen, I got so much data today, I haven't gotten to any of it. According to Nielsen, the average American household consumes 10.2 10 hours and 39 minutes of TV, tablets, and phone entertainment. The one that really weirded me out was an hour and 20 minutes of entertainment on your phone. Go to the TV, it's bigger. I mean, this is the one thing about phone and movies I never really understood. Movies, and I teach at NYU and I try to get kids to come in and watch movies. And nobody wants to come anymore because everyone can watch them on their phone. But I try to explain to them that seeing, you know, a Fritz Lang film or a Woody Allen film or we watched a Taxi Driver on a big screen, it's like a whole different experience. I mean, this, you know, this face is this big. It's a real, I saw things I hadn't seen before because I never saw it on a big screen. But again, think of what's happening. So much time dwelling, almost half of a day, dwelling in an alternate reality, which is setting for you the norms of behavior, sexuality, consumption, and politics. Donald Trump's people really seem to think that he has all of the tools necessary to solve every single problem we have. And if you listen to his speech today, there was a tremendous amount of I. I mean, this was demagogic in the extreme. It is not an accident, I think, that fascism, which is the only political movement that is invented in the 20th century, is essentially part and parcel of the ability to mass propagandize at the same time. And so what was propaganda for Trump? The Apprentice. All of those names of his on buildings all over the world that, remember, he doesn't really own. Arguably, he doesn't want to release his taxes because it will let a window into the reality of his economic status as opposed to the image of his economic status. Again, how many layers of constructed personality and reality exist before we get to the real Donald Trump, whatever the fuck that means? All I know is from watching him a lot now on stage, when other people are talking, when he can't talk, he moves his mouth, he can't sit still, he can't concentrate. The people have given him a brief and say his attention wanders almost immediately. Just who is this real Donald Trump? I mean, I personally, and I certainly wouldn't want to impose my views on anyone in this room, but I personally think that Trump has zero of the skills necessary for the task he's actually facing. And it gets even weirder. I think Donald Trump, because of the particular nature of political and entertainment culture in America, didn't have a fucking clue of what it was actually like to be president. It was like this really important job, and everybody knew who you were, and a guy who's as narcissistic as him would want a job where everybody knows who I am. I mean, if Donald Trump was interested in, and I was thinking about this on the subway in today, if Donald Trump was actually interested in politics, as he's claimed to have always been, there's nothing that would have stopped him 30 years ago from running for a Congress office or a senatorial office and making his way up the economic ladder that is politics, right? But rather, no, where did he make his jump from? He didn't even make his jump, like Rockefeller, from the business world, right? He made it from the entertainment platform, from that TV show on NBC. And remember, before that, he did worldwide wrestling, WWE. Now, I do have a soft spot in my heart for pro wrestling. I do, because I can remember, and here's a great example of creating reality. During the Iranian hostage crisis in 1979 and 1980, one of the greatest, most important bouts every Saturday on WOR Channel 9 at 3 p.m. was watching Sergeant Slaughter beat the shit out of the Iron Sheik, who dared to walk around with an Iranian flag. And every time, just as Sergeant Slaughter was about to lose, all the crowd had to do was start chanting, USA! USA, and then Sergeant Slaughter would gain his strength from this crowd. We would all see American patriotism vindicated and finally defeating these horrible sheiks. It's the same fucking thing that's going on in 24 when I must torture this guy because he has the knowledge of where a bomb is. There is zero historical moments in which there were seconds to stop a bomb and you had a guy who knew where it was. Even the Israeli military admits that. There is not one scenario in which we've ever had to do this. Intelligence officials will tell you that torturing people is not a good way to get information. That's why Zero Dark 30 is so motherfucking fucked up. What it did is it allowed the CIA to cast its enhanced interrogation techniques as actually useful in getting good information. The reality of our war on terror has been that when we have taken the route most telegenic, i.e. violent, i.e. spectacular, it has been a colossal failure. If shock and awe was not a military tactic created, designed, and implemented exactly for the 24-hour news cycle, nothing has been. I mean, you gave it a name. Shock and awe. What are we going to do? We're going to shock them, and then we're going to awe them, and then they're going to give in. Because our shocking is so awe-inspiring. And don't forget, for television consumption, the war had a countdown clock. The war had a name, Operation Iraqi Freedom. It's freedom for the Iraqis. How could it be bad? You know, like the king of beers. It must be the best beer. It's the king of beers. I mean, there may be an emperor of beers, but that's for the Chinese market. You know, that's a different thing. So what we need to think about here is that this entertainment industrial complex, this telling of stories, this diversion of watching a movie or engorging in, you know, 18 hours straight of Mad Men nostalgia is maybe not just sort of some harmless pastime. It actually shapes our understanding of the universe. It shapes our political attitudes, both pro and con. It shapes our attitude towards ourselves. I mean, most sociologists don't think it's an accident that until Fiji, the island of Fiji, got television, they had no body dysmorphic disorder. Body dysmorphic disorder is usually described as some interesting combination of individual psychological malady and sociocultural circumstances. When you push out what a body image should be like, you're norming it. When you norm it that way, that's how people think life should be. A happy marriage, a one person that you'll always love forever, a suit that makes you just right. I mean, and the reality, of course, is that every single thing in a movie, in a commercial, in a TV show is intricately planned down to the last detail for the desired effect. To the point where no magazine cover is any sort of depiction of reality. It's the fantasy of a Photoshopper. The same thing goes for our movies. If you had the ability while you're watching a film, Star Wars, Avatar, fuck, take your pick, and you could step back and see the artifice. See that it's a blue screen or now a green screen. See that it's only 3/4 of a room with lights hanging from it. See that it's not a real thing. That would be quite jarring. And so what's interesting, again, we have to think about is our reality shaped by reality? Or is our reality shaped by the perceptions and the projections of what we want reality to be as we consume it in the form of distraction and innocent entertainment? I would put forth that, in fact, it's much more insidious. And here's the last thing I'll leave you with. Puritans, and we all are, oh, Puritans, wow, Puritans are so controlling. They made you sit in church for 6 hours every Sunday. And they take their children out to the graveyard and say, "See what ye awaits ye, death and sin!" And that was enough programming to get the Puritan kids to go, "Ah! Death and sin, death and sin. We gotta kill the witch, kill that witch, kill that." I mean, this, like, Puritans were like pretty cohesive in their fear of everything. That's 6 hours once a week. If we're watching 10 hours a day, the possibility for programming, brainwashing, and attitude creation is unfucking believable. So next time we all sit down in front of our TV, our tablet, our phone, or our new brain implant that projects the image right on the back of my fucking cornea, which is, you know what they want next, think about what we're doing. Are we engaging? Are we escaping? Are we turning off? Or are we allowing our reality to be molded around a whole new thing of which we're not even aware it's happening? That's the end of my presentation. We'll take some questions.